Hello everyone, this is Mandeep Kaur, the director at Air Preservation Private Limited, and I welcome all the guests for the today's international cabin crew course. So today we have one of our aviation professionals, Neha Arora, who is the flight attendant, and she's here to guide you all about the particular course. So over to you, Neha.
Right, thank you, Mandeep. Hi guys, as Mandeep already mentioned, my name, I'm Neha Arora. I'm an experienced flight attendant with a demonstrated history of working with the international airline. I was working with Qatar Airways and Vistara. Started my career with Vistara and then I moved to Qatar. And before becoming a cabin crew, I was working as a travel advisor with British Airways. So total 7 years of experience in aviation. Good to have you all over here. Hi, Suparna, how are you?
Fine. What about you?
I'm great, great, great. Thank you. Having hard time, huh?
Very much eager to attend the session.
No problem. As long as you're dedicated, we are good.
Me.
Thank you.
Me.
So, without wasting further time, I'm going to start the session, all right? So we'll start with the introduction, all right? And along with that, I also want to cover a topic. So it will be covered simultaneously, all right? So please keep an eye on my screen and then we will proceed with the introduction part, okay? Great. All right, Suparna, can you see my screen? I believe it is visible.
Yes, it is. Yes.
Okay, great. All right. Okay. The art of self-introduction. All right. So self-introduction plays a very important role in your personal and professional life, right? So meeting someone personally, let's say not in an office or in a meeting, but socially, right? So self-introduction plays a very, very important role in your daily life, okay? So self-introduction is both a personal and professional communication skills that are needed in your everyday life. And your introduction should tell people who you are and it should encourage people to engage in conversation with you, all right? So self-introduction plays a very, very important role in an interview, okay? So when you'll be giving an interview anywhere, be it aviation or MNC, corporate, anywhere, this is one of the most important thing that we need to take care of, all right? So basically you will tell people or a person in front of you about who you are, all right? And that will make them more interested in talking to you. Makes sense, right? Because if they don't know, they would not be able to comfortable in having a conversation. Right, so that is why self-introduction is one of the most important phase of an interview. So what are the importance of self-introduction? Why do we do it? Right? So people learn about introduction, always include about your little bit about your personal life and your professional life. Right? You become familiar to everyone. For example, you are in a room where nobody knows you. But once you introduce yourself, everybody will know where you are from, who you are, and a little bit about yourself, right? Briefly about yourself. A sense of trust and belief is created in them. And there's a possibility of opening up new opportunities for you, all right? So there are endless possibilities that would come up if you introduce yourself in a right way to somebody. All right. So that is one of the most important point of self-introduction. All right. Now, the activity that I want you to do is which is a part of the introduction as well, I want you to introduce yourself to me, all right? And I'll tell you how to do it, okay? You have to do it in a certain way. So what you need to do is, first we'll start with, let's say good evening, okay? Or good afternoon, okay? Good afternoon, my name is Dash. You have to mention your name. I live in, or I am from, or I belong to. Okay, you have to name the place where you are coming from. All right. For example, if you are born in, I'm just giving an example, born in Uttar Pradesh and raised in Delhi, you can mention that as well. But do not say I am born and born in Uttar Pradesh and brought up in Delhi, or born and brought up in Delhi. All right. It is always born and raised in Delhi. All right. So that does, or otherwise you can just say I belong to, let's say, Chennai, or I'm from Chennai. That's all. Right. Make it simple. Then as per my education qualification, or if you are currently working, then you can start with your experience. Right. So I have done my graduation or 12th from so-and-so university, and I'm pursuing graduation right now. But if you have done it, and I have done my graduation from so-and-so university, then your hobbies. I like to do this. I enjoy doing this. I'm fond of this. Like, you have to mention your hobby, all right? Then one thing I want you to mention, like, this is not the part of your self-introduction where in an interview, it could be if they will ask for it, but I am asking for you to mention your goal, okay, your ambition. So I want to become, then your ambition, all right? And conclude, the last point should be, that's all about me. All right, so this is how you will conclude. Okay, so now, Suparna, I would like you to introduce yourself in a way I told you.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Hello everyone. My name is Suparna Bhattavian. I am belong to Chennai and I born in Kolkata. Now I am a mother of a 3 years old kid, and I completed my study in Padwan University. I did master's in English from that university. And right now I am completely engaged myself in as a homemaker only. But my dream is, I am also a big dreamer and ambitious. I want to become an air hostess. It's just like I am joining a session today. It's like my dream came true. So that's all about me. My hobby is like I'm fond of music. I'm fond of singing and spirituality practices. I like that. Thank you
Suparna, very well tried. Just few things I want you to improve on. So like I said, you mentioned that you are born in Kolkata and raised in Chennai, right? So this is how you should say, like, I'm born in Kolkata and raised in Chennai.
Okay.
All right, but if you don't want to mention about Kolkata, all you can say is I am from Chennai.
Okay.
Or I am from Kolkata, it's up to you. Okay. But if you want to mention the entire statement, then it should be, I'm born in Kolkata and raised in Chennai, right?
Okay.
You have done your schooling, I believe, in Chennai, right?
Yeah.
Your education.
Yeah. That was,
okay. And about the education qualification, always start with the highest one. Since you mentioned that you've done your master's, right?
Yes.
So I have completed my master's in English from so-and-so university. Right, and that includes your graduation in 12th, of course, right? Because you have done graduation, then only you jump to master's.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
So I've done my master's in English honors from this university. And I think you forgot to mention your hobbies, but you covered up at the end, no problem. And yes, about your ambition, just one statement. I want to become a cabin crew. Okay, avoid saying air hostess anymore.
Okay.
Because the term, the designation is not air hostess anymore. In the aviation industry, as per DGCA, we do not refer cabin crew as air hostess anymore.
So,
we used to be. That's why I know a lot of people, they are, they say it like that. But we are flight attendant or cabin crew. So, great.
Thank you.
Very well tried. We're going to do it every day. All right, because we have to improve, right?
Yes.
Wonderful. Any questions in that? Anything you want to ask?
Okay, great.
And Suparna, one more thing. I'm Neha. Please call me by my name. Neha is fine.
Thank you,
ma'am. Great. Neha, please.
Okay, Neha.
Great. Even in aviation industry, you know, you will find people where, like in industry, in aviation industry, they will not let you call ma'am or sir to them. They don't like it. So refer everyone by their name. And if you think they are very elder or something, or maybe in a very good position, senior to you, all you can do is just refer them by Mr. and their last name. So like for me, if someone doesn't want to call my name, they can refer me as Miss Arora, right? But for you, please call my first name. And when you join some airline or something, and maybe you're talking
bless
to
me,
of course you will. Yeah.
Thank you.
For example, you're talking to the CEO, you don't have to call sir to him, just refer, like, let's say Mr. Sharma.
Okay.
All right, wonderful.
Yeah, thank you.
Now moving ahead, since you mentioned that you want to become a cabin crew, right? I want to ask you a question, that what do you think, what all are the benefits of becoming a cabin crew? As for you, what all are the perks of becoming a cabin crew? You can try and then I will give you an answer. Yeah. All right. So, first of all, you travel the world, and I'm sure you know about it, right? So, if you are a crew, if you become a crew, if you join any international airline or even domestic, you travel the world, right? You are paid to travel, right? So, you will be paid to travel all over the world because you will be working on board.
Yes, yes.
Right? Flight cannot take off without you.
Yes.
Amazing remuneration.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. So you will be getting a very amazing salary being a part of the aviation industry as a cabin, right? Easier promotion, but this depends upon your performance every time, all right? So they will always check your productivity, right? How you are doing on board, how are your customer service skills on board, how many appreciation letter you are getting from the passenger. So all these things will come, and then they will decide if they want to promote you to the different cabin or not. So you will always start from the economy cabin, right? And then you will move to the business class and then first class. So this is how it works, right? Then staff travel. So if you're working for any airline, you're eligible to get a staff travel benefit, wherein you'll be getting rebated tickets, discounted tickets to travel as a staff. Even in your, like, it can be your personal travel as well for leisure. Let's say you're going on holidays, you can use the staff travel benefit, and then you can fly anywhere. Friends from all the culture. So since I mentioned I was a part of Qatar Airways, I had friends from different culture, different countries, because we were like 156 nationalities working together over there. So in Qatar Airways, over 156 nationalities are working, right? So then you have friends from everywhere, and not only your colleagues, you'll be meeting a lot of passengers on board from different background, different culture, different countries, right? So communicate with them. You know, you will find a lot of people on your way, right? Access to 5-star hotels and restaurants. So whenever you will be going to a country, like you are on your, working, right? And you are going somewhere else, let's say from Delhi to New York, right? You will be staying over there for a day, let's say, because of course you need to rest. You cannot do a flight of 15 hours to come back, right? So then you will be staying in a 5-star hotel, and lot of airlines, they have a partnership with lot of hotels as well. So even when you are going on your leisure trip, you can book a hotel with that benefit as well. Okay. So this is actually different with different airlines. So once you become a part of one, you will understand better, right? Okay. So these are the benefits of becoming a flight attendant. All right, excited?
Very much.
I'm sure. Great. So now I'm gonna start with the most important part of the interview. So we spoke about self-introduction, right? But that was not the first impression, right? Self-introduction is not the first impression. The first impression is the grooming, right? So how are you gonna go? How are you going to get dressed if you're going for the interview, right? So this is the first topic that I'm gonna start with, which is grooming, right? If you want, you can make notes, up to you, because handwritten notes are always better to refer to anytime. Okay, before that, I also want to cover one more topic before starting with the grooming, because that is, again, a very basic thing that you should know, all right? So we'll be starting with phonetics. Any idea what phonetics are?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, I have completed my pre-primary teaching diploma also, so I know that phonetics means A sound, B sound, like this?
Yeah, so in aviation industry, we have different vocabulary for that, right? Okay. Like in India, we use A as an apple, B as in boy, right? So that is very common. But when you are working with any MNC, any international company, or aviation, in aviation, all right? So this is what you're going to use when you want to spell anything for anyone, okay? It's going to be A as in Alpha,
okay.
B as in Bravo, C as in Charlie. So you need to memorize all of that.
Okay.
Like for me, if I need to spell my name for someone, it's going to be my name is Noha, N as in November, E as in Echo, H as in Hotel, A as well.
Okay.
This is how I'm going to spell anything.
Okay.
Right? Especially over the phone. Okay, if I'm talking to someone over the phone, it is very hard to catch words at that point of time. And then you need to spell, right? So this is what you're going to use, because they will not understand B as in boy or D as in dog, right? So always, always use these phonetics. If you want, you can take a screenshot of it. And tomorrow we'll practice it with your name, okay?
Okay.
So you will spell your name for me tomorrow, okay?
Okay.
You can take a screenshot.
Yeah.
Done?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. I'll just go through it once. Okay. Alpha, Bravo, Charlie, Delta, Echo, Foxtrot, Golf, Hotel, India, Juliet, Kilo, Lima, Mike, November, Oscar, Papa, Quebec, Romeo, Sierra, Tango, Uniform, Victor, Whiskey, X-ray, Yankee, and Zoo. Right? So tomorrow you're gonna do it for me. And now I'm gonna share different screen with you, and we're gonna start with the group part. It's visible, right? So, Subarna, what do you mean by grouping?
Grouping is like, I think, the way I have to present myself in front of clients and the way I have to communicate with them and respond. How should I respond to my passengers?
Right. First of all, we'll be talking about like the personality, right? Like how we look at this, right? And later on, we'll talk about the like how you will respond to someone. How you'll be talking, right? That is later on. But today, I'm gonna cover about your physical appearance. All right. So, starting with this. So, grooming is an art of enhancing one's overall appearance, and this includes cleaning of face, hair, and skin. Right.
Okay.
So this is just not for the interview. Anywhere, if you're going anywhere, maybe to a restaurant or hotel, let's say anywhere, then this will come into the picture. All right. You should know what you'll be wearing, how you should look if you're going on in a particular place. Right. But we'll be talking specifically about the interview, about the cabin. Right. Okay. So grooming is usually referred in two ways. The first one is about cleaning and maintaining the body parts, right? That includes your face, skin, and hair. And the one that you mentioned, that was absolutely correct. Enhancing overall personality, that includes appearance, attitude, communication, and social etiquette, right? When you said that how I will be communicating with the, let's say, client or interviewer or passengers on board, right? So this is also a very important part of your grooming, right? So about cleaning and maintaining the body parts, we'll first talk about the face and skin, right? So what is your daily regime? How are you taking care of your face? You can tell me anything that you are doing.
I use only water on my face because my 3 years old, it's too much naughty. I
you don't get time.
Huh? 5 years, more
time. Yeah. No worries, no. But I should suggest, like, you know, you should start taking care of your face, your skin.
Yes, I should.
Right?
Yeah.
And that is not like a very lengthy process or something, not time consuming at all. What you need to do is just three things that you need to follow is face wash, toner, and moisturizer. So every time you're cleaning your face, do just these three things, which is, of course, cleansing, which if any face wash, that suits you. Right, then toner. If you don't have a toner, you can go for rose water. Okay, just cotton, few drops of rose water, and just wipe it on your face. All right, then moisturizer, any moisturizer that suits your skin. All right, and of course, I have a few slides that where I'm gonna ask what type of skin you have, and then I could suggest better stuff to you. All right. And enhancing overall percent and hair as well. Okay, hair. Now, follow whatever regime you're following right now. All right. But then when you will become a cabin crew, all right, you need to take care, you need to take extra care of your hair. All right. I'm just being honest with you, right? Oiling, shampoo, conditioner, everything is must. All right. But buy a mild shampoo for your hair. All right. Do not go harsh with it. Right, mild shampoo without paraben and SLS are perfect. Right, enhancing overall personality, that includes your appearance, attitude, communication, social etiquette. All right, so your first impression is your appearance. Right, let's say you're going for the interview, the way you are dressed, right, the way you're walking, the way you are sitting is your first impression. Attitude, what kind of attitude you are reflecting over there, right? It could be towards others, or maybe you are just sitting but not reflecting very positive attitude, right? Communication is when you will start talking to someone, right? When you will start talking to the interviewer, then this will come into the picture. And social etiquette, it's like the kind of hand gestures, leg movements, right, that you are using, right? So I'm sure you go to the restaurant with your friends, right? So the kind of social etiquette that you're following over there, all right, to maintain all those things, right? Grooming plays an important role in every profession. So not just cabin crew, it plays an important role in every profession. All right. Be a person going to the office every day or a cabin crew going for a flight every day. All right. It plays like important, equal role in every profession. All right. So signs of well-groomed person. So careful about the clothes, washing, ironing, and cleaning. All right. So whenever you become a cabin crew, all right, your uniform has to be intact, impeccable, all right? It should be free of stains and creases, right? So proper ironing and cleaning is must of the uniform, right? Because you will be, again, you have to maintain that name of your airline, right? You have to maintain that, right? You'll be reflecting the airline personality, I should say, right? Well-polished, clean, and tidy footwear, all right? So make sure, right attire at right place. One point I missed, so right attire at right place. So what do we mean by that over here? Like what you'll be wearing if you're going for the interview, right? What you'll be wearing, for example, you have a layover, but you are still on your duty. So, for example, you're traveling from Delhi to New York, right? And you are on your duty right now. You're traveling as a cabin, all right? Delhi to New York, and you will be staying there for one day. In the hotel, also, you have to maintain that decorum, right? So, you will be expected to wear right attire at the hotel also, all right? Because they know which airline you are coming from. Right, so you have to maintain that. Well-polished, clean, and tidy footwear, right? Please keep your shoes clean and tidy and polished all the time, especially if you're going for the interview. They will notice that, all right? They are noticing that every time, all right? Because it plays a very important role when you're going on board. Your grooming will be checked every day before the flight without fail, right? Socks are clean and fresh, right? This actually make more sense for the guys, but for you as well, if you are, let's say, wearing stockings, right, then it should be clean and fresh and should not be torn, right? Trimmed and clean nails, right? So if you have long nails, it cannot be longer than more than 1 centimeter, just 1 centimeter. All right, and it is again totally depend upon your airline also. They will let you know, all right? And it should be clean. Nail paint is fine as long as it is professional. The color should not be, blue or neon, you know? They're very much in trend right now, but you cannot wear it while you are going for the flight. Okay, so basic colors, pink, red would do, but then your airline will tell you because they have certain rules when it comes to grooming, which you need to follow. So that's why I'm not going to comment on the colors part. Follow what your, like whatever your airline have rules, right? Follow that rules, right? Healthy and smooth skin. This is something that you need to maintain, right? So the air in the flight is very, very dry, right? So if you will not take care of your skin at that point of time, you will get breakouts, pigmentation. So it is very important to maintain healthy skin when you become a cabin crew, right? Regular hair washing is must. As I mentioned, the air in the cabin would be very, very dry. So you need to take extra care of your hair and skin, right? Respect everyone, right? Respect everyone, be it your colleagues, can be junior or a senior, ticket passenger, anyone, respect everyone. And if you're working in, let's say, an MNC, they also respect your colleagues, right? And follow social etiquettes, okay, one of the most important part of a well-groomed person, right? Any doubts on that?
No.
Okay. So moving ahead. You see, neat hair, clean makeup, warm smile, professional outfit, body language and posture. Right? This is how it should be. Right, especially for your interview and for your cabin crew journey, your airline will take care of your grooming thing because they have to tell you about all the, you know, colors and the grooming standards that they're expecting out of you, right? Okay. So basic skincare, as I already mentioned about the CTM, which is the cleansing, toning and moisturizing regime. So skin is the first thing that come into notice during any personal interaction, right? And it is important for professionals, especially from the service industry, to have bright, clear and glowing skin, right? So it is very, very important to take care of your skin. Whenever you're going for the interview, if your skin is clean, you know, it will look good. But if you have breakouts or pimple, which is very natural, take care. That's not a big problem. But then, you know, you can just take care of your skin to avoid all those things. But sometimes those are unavoidable also, right? So make sure you hide them, right? By the makeup. You need to apply makeup to hide if you have any spots or acne or pimple, all right? But if you start take care of your skin, you know, a little extra care for it, then trust me, they will not occur very frequent, acne and pimples and blemishes, right? And it is important for professionals, especially from the service industry, to have bright, clear and glowing skin. It is for you only, all right? Because I'm sure nobody wants to apply makeup on breakouts, right? If you have pimple, you do want to apply makeup on it. So it's like, just take care of your skin from the beginning itself, all right? But just in case if you have something on your face, hide it. Hide it. Makeup is absolutely fine. It is a complete myth that makeup can spoil your skin or something. Choose the right product and makeup is absolutely okay for the skin. All right. It's just that you need to choose the right product for yourself. Right? Do not use expired makeup. Always check the validity. Right? So this is how you can take care of your skin. Any doubts? Okay. No problem. All right. So some common threats to skin. This is like ultraviolet rays. Ultraviolet rays, when you are, let's say, traveling or when you're just going out from your place for shopping in like afternoon, right? So then this is harmful for the skin. Ultraviolet rays, excessive warm water. So warm water is advisable, but just once or twice in a day. All right, you can just put a few drops of lemon and then you can have it once or twice a day. It is actually good for skin, but do not drink it like every time. Okay, excessive warm water is not good for your skin. Once in the morning with few drops of lemon is completely fine. All right, it is actually good. Excessive makeup. All right, so first of all, choose the right product, and whenever you are back at your place, wash your face thoroughly. All right, do not sleep with your makeup on. Okay, so excessive makeup is also a threat to skin. Right, always use the makeup remover before washing your face. Okay, then poor quality of makeup. Okay, I'm missing up over here. So poor quality of makeup also. So always get good quality, good brands. First check if something is suiting you or not. Okay, it's advisable to do a test before you use it, right? So you need to buy the best quality of makeup for your skin, all right? Any doubts, Suparna, in that?
No, all clear.
All right. Now, the type of skin. Oily, dry, normal, sensitive, and combination. All right, so Suparna, I want to ask you over here, what type of skin you have?
My skin is oily. I don't have any so-called black type. It's a God-gifted. I till now I didn't have any skin problem.
That's great. I hope you never get it in future.
Yes.
Right, that's good. So you said you have oily skin, so I'm assuming you get oil mostly here on your everywhere basically, right? Chin, cheeks, nose, forehead.
Nose, sometimes on cheeks. But I like oily skin because I think it makes you glamour.
Oil is actually essential for your skin, all right, but not the excess oil on your skin.
If
your skin is producing oil, it's okay, it is moisturized, right? It's fine. But if you think it's not that much, then you have normal skin. You think your face doesn't produce a lot of oil, then it's normal. So this is how you're gonna start take care of your skin once you know what type of skin you have. Right, so normal. And about the sensitive skin, do you think that you cannot use a lot of products because they may react on your skin or something? Ever come across?
First of all, I like to be simple. I like to be natural.
Natural.
Because I always think that but the skin I have gifted from God, it's enough for me. So my favorite makeup is lipstick, eyeliner, and mascara only. I didn't apply any foundation, nothing.
That's great. But I would advise you, not every day, but if you are going somewhere, you can use, if you said your skin is clear, right? No spots or something.
Yes, you can go
for the BB cream. It's absolutely fine to use it if you're going out. Right, okay. BB cream is fine. But once you become a cabin crew, foundation is one of the necessary thing that you need to put every day. Okay, and your grooming instructor over there would come to know right away that you haven't applied any foundation. Right, it's very visible also. Yeah. So, since you said that you do not have any pimples or blemishes or spots, you can go for the low coverage one.
Okay.
A foundation which is low coverage.
Okay.
Right. Even I use the low coverage one. I do not use it every day. Just sometimes, occasionally. Of course, I used to use it every day when I was going for the flight. But now, use it occasionally.
Okay.
Right. And always test products before using them. All right. So whenever you will be going to buy a foundation, always test on your jawline. Okay, do not put it on your forearms. Always jawline. Only over here you can you will be able to see the match of your skin and the foundation color, if it is getting along or not.
Okay.
Right, so always jawline, and then give it some time to also get merged with your skin. Right, so for example, you're going to a mall, just test a foundation over here, then do your entire shopping, come back to that store, after half an hour, 45 minutes, just to see how it is looking after getting blended or something, after getting merged with the skin. Okay, do not buy it instantly. This is what I do, and this is what I have been taught. And I think this is the best way to buy the foundation. Right? Great. So, this is one of the amazing regime that you can follow. Okay, you can take a screenshot of it as well. So this is the essentials for a glowing skin. So since you said that you didn't get so much of time to take care of yourself, but just take out some time to do this, right? These points that is mentioned over here, and your skin will remain healthy. Right. So maintain a nutritious and high fiber diet, which should have balance intake of vitamins and natural proteins. All right. So diet plays a very, very important role in maintaining your healthy skin, right? So you need to maintain the nutritious and high fiber diet, right? Having junk once in a while is no problem. Okay, I will not tell you to stop it entirely. You can just do it once, maybe in 10 days, it's fine. But then mostly maintain the nutritious diet and high fiber diet, all right? Intake of vitamins and natural proteins. Detoxify the skin by taking lemon water every day. So as I mentioned, you can take warm water in the morning, empty stomach with a few drops of lemon to detoxify your skin. All right, just once in the morning and that's all. All right, fruit should be taken regularly. Intake of citrus fruit, which are like oranges, you can have oranges. Essentials as they contain vitamin C, and vitamin C is the most important. It plays a very important role in maintaining your skin healthy. You can use face wash that has vitamin C. Okay, so absolutely fine. At least take at least 12 glasses of water every day. Okay, very easy to say, very hard to maintain, but do it. All right, so 12 glasses of water every day. Okay. You can take it more as well, all right? Do not just think only 12. Drink as much as you can, water only, all right? You can have fresh juices also, all right? That is also a good regime to follow. And use the correct sunscreen. So since I mentioned that whenever you're going out, your skin is getting contact with ultraviolet rays, right? So this is how you can protect your skin, which is the correct sunscreen. Right? Always make it a habit of using sunscreen. Okay, should be at least SPF 50. Okay, cleanse, tone, moisturize the skin daily. So this is the CTM that I was talking about. Always clean your face with the cleanser, then toner, or you can use rose water instead of toner. It's absolutely fine. It's a natural toner, right? Then you can moisturize. Use your Anastable moisturizer for your skin. Exfoliate. So do you scrub your skin? Do you use scrub? Use it once. If you think, see, blackheads, and sometimes people who don't have blackheads, they get whiteheads, which is actually not visible, right? So always exfoliate once in a week or once in 10 days, up to you. All right, get a good scrub. It is very, very important to remove dirt to take out blackheads and whiteheads from the pores. All right, so that's why this is advisable to do it. After scrubbing, cleanse, tone, and moisturize, because you need to clog the pores as well, all right? Preventing all other, dirts and particles going into the pores. So always cleanse, tone, and moisturize, and you can always scrub once in a week, right? Do not leave the makeup for long hours, all right? So makeup is absolutely fine, but whenever you're getting back at home, always wash your face. Always remove the makeup with the help of makeup remover. Get a good makeup remover, right? And then wash your face. Okay? Avoid mental stress. Stay happy and positive, right? So do not take any unnecessary stress, all right? Do not get angry. Always stay happy and positive, because anything that you feel, it comes on your face as well naturally. And I'm assuming since you have 3 years old at your place, you're always happy with him, right? So play with your kid and stay happy. Whatever tension that you have, okay, I know it's very, very natural to come on your face as well. And especially when you're going for the flight, you need to leave all the tensions and everything stress back at your place, all right? You cannot take it along with you on flight, because then people will find you grumpy over there and they would not like to talk to you, right? So this is one of the most important points that you need to follow. Any question in that? Super.
Okay, great.
So hair care, key minerals and vitamins for healthy hair. Biotin, iron, omega-3 protein, vitamin A and E, vitamin C and zinc. Right? So you can get in touch with your doctor or dermatologist, because I am taking multivitamins, because I know the kind of food that we are eating is not actually sufficient to give us all these key minerals and vitamins. Okay, so it is working for me, and you can also check with your dermatologist and start taking multivitamins, which is good for your skin and hair, depending if you have any hair problem or not. All right, a mild shampoo and conditioner is sufficient, and always oil your hair once in a week. Okay, just on the scalp. Do not put oil on hair strands, just on the scalp. All right, that's all. That's actually sufficient. And do you have any hair problem? Do you think?
Yes, hair fall. Chennai water is so salt.
Hard.
That's why hard. Yeah, it's so hard. That's why.
Yeah, it's actually important to water plays a very, very important role in making your hair healthy, right? So I actually face this kind of problem like back in Delhi somewhere when we were not getting soft water, and then I started buying water just for my hair, you know? Yeah, so it happens. Or you can use drinking water, right? Like if you have RO at your place, you can use that water for your hair. It's absolutely fine. And since it's mentioned that you are having hair fall, then your hair is lacking in biotin, actually, right? So you can get a shampoo which has biotin, or you can eat multivitamins which has biotin, and then you will feel some changes for sure. And always check with your dermatologist as well, right, to maintain your health care. So hair types based on quality. So what type of hair do you have? Oily, dry, or normal?
Before marriage, my hair is like a normal hair, but after in Chennai, you know, my hair became very dull and no shiny.
No shiny. Okay. Do you use conditioner, by the way, or just shampoo?
Just shampoo only. No conditioner.
You need to add conditioner for sure, because if your hair are dry and then you're just using shampoo, then that is the mistake that you're making. Always get the conditioner, always put the conditioner after shampoo, and make sure you are using both of them like of the same brand.
Okay,
so you can check at the marketplace, or if you're buying it online, check the same condition of that brand.
Okay.
And the same ingredients. Okay. And how about the texture? What kind of texture do you have?
My hair is like, it's a little bit curly.
Curly. Okay. Curly. All right. Yeah. That's why I think it's frizzy and dry, no? But when you start using conditioner, you will feel changes, because shampoo actually makes your hair dry, right? If you are not using conditioner.
Okay.
After that, okay? Start using it.
Okay.
So, some common hair precautions. Avoid harsh hair treatment as much as possible. That is like smoothing or perming, or okay, rebonding, right? So you avoid using these kind of treatment, right? Don't rub your hair with towel for dry. All right, if I'm not sure if you have seen that soft towel, those are actually designed for your hair, so that is also readily available in the market. Or if you don't want to buy it, you can just use a cotton cloth. That is absolutely fine for drying. But do not rub your hair. You can just tie your towel for a while, okay? And then they will get dry on their own. You don't have to rub it, okay? Always dry the hair naturally as far as possible. So dry it like naturally only. Do not use excessive hair dryer until you have to pee somewhere urgently, right? So naturally is the best way to dry, all right? Avoid using hair dryers and blow dryers and all. Avoid brushing wet hair, okay? Let your hair dry completely and then comb them or brush them, all right? Because this is one of the reason that makes your hair frizzy. And of course, hair fall. So if you just brush on your wet hair, you tend to get more hair out and it becomes frizzy with time, all right? Do not wash your hair daily, okay? Let the scalp produce oil in on your scalp as well. Let your scalp produce the oil so that they can also use natural way to moisturize, right? But if you will wash your hair daily, then your scalp will become dry with time. Your scalp will stop producing oil. So avoid washing hair daily, all right? Apply shampoo on the scalp and not the hair. So shampoo are meant to clean the scalp, not hair, all right? So always apply shampoo on the scalp to cleanse it, and always apply conditioner on hair, okay? So over here, only conditioner and shampoo on your scalp only. Okay, and even oil on your scalp only, all right? Do not apply over here on your hair, all right? And yeah, any questions, Parna, in that? Anything you want to add?
No, okay.
Anything that you are doing for your hair except shampoo and oil? Anything different? Maybe hair mask or something?
Once in a year, I use like henna. I did not color. Henna I use.
Henna is fine. Henna is absolutely fine. Yeah. But then it also, henna also make, it actually makes your hair stronger also. At the same time, it makes your hair dry as well. So that's why use conditioner. I'm not asking you to do not use henna. Use it, but then use conditioner also. All right. So that your hair will not be dry anymore.
Yeah. For color only, I use like tea liquor and egg.
Okay.
And lemon, all these things I use.
That's good. That's good. If you are making your own hair mask, it's absolutely fine. Great that you get time to do all these things. I have stopped actually, and I should start making these hair masks and applying on my head as well. Great. So makeup and hairstyles. So first we'll start with the makeup. You see the list for the men is so less, and for us, it's like never ending. So for women, cleansers, it's actually for both of them. So cleansers like face wash, right? Cleansing your skin with the face wash. Foundation, compact. Concealer is like when you have discoloration. Okay, if you have spots, right? If you have dark circles, then you can hide it with the help of concealers. Right, moisturizer, blusher, eye palettes for like eyeshadow, right? Mascara, you said you use it, right? Eyeliner, eyeshadow, eyebrow pencil to make your eyebrows a little thick and prominent, kajal, lipstick, and lip liner. All right. So in some of the airline, lip liner is optional. It's up to you if you want to highlight your lips or not, all right? But rest, all of the things are kind of mandatory. So if I talk about my experience with Vistara, we had to use all of it except lip liner. I mean, that was optional, right? But with Qatar, the grooming was pretty, pretty easy. So we just used to use foundation, compact, blusher, mascara, and lipstick. Liner was not mandatory, eyeshadow was not mandatory, you know, just few things. So as I told you, your grooming instructor in the airline, like whenever you'll be joining any airline, they will let you know what to use, right? What makeup they are looking for, and then you have to follow the same, all right? So this is pretty much that. And for men, just few things, moisturizer, concealer, even if, I mean, if they have spots or something. Sunscreen is also important for you. It's not mentioned over here, but sunscreen, it's like, make it a habit to put sunscreen whenever you're going out, right? So this is bun. Do you know how to make a bun? No worries. Have you seen like donut bun? It is readily available in the market. It is in the shape of donut. It helps to make, you know, a prominent bun for the for your flight, or if you are going for the interview or anywhere.
Yeah.
So you can get that. This is one of the best and easiest, you know, way to make a bun. Even I cannot make it with the braid or something. I always use this to make bun for me. Even if I'm going out now, I make, like if I want to make bun, I use donut. Even with long hair, I cannot make bun without it. It's pretty easy to make a bun with donut. You just need to follow the steps wherein you have to make a high ponytail. All right. And you just need to put your ponytail through the hole in the middle. Right. And then you need to cover the entire donut with your ponytail, with your hair hanging over there. Right. To settle them, you need to put a rubber band. And then you just need to pin up the leftover hair over here, right? So, like this, you know? With the help of U-pins, right? Hairspray are used to put the baby hair back, right? So, if you have a lot of baby hair, frizzy hair, you need to use the hairspray to settle it, right? And you're good to go. So this is how your bun will look. All right. We can do it practically, virtually. Also, I will let you know how to do it, how to make it. All right. We'll do it like in a day or two. All right. So, one second. This is for men. Where is it? Yeah. Okay, so this is the most important thing that you need to follow: neatly tied back hair. All right, no fringes are allowed. With full makeup, dress code, business attire, and shoes, wear heels. All right, whenever you'll be going for the interview, sometimes the airline, they expect you to follow the attire for the interview. You need to follow that. If not, then you can just wear business formals for the interview. All right. So it can be trousers or skirts. Shirt, blazers are optional. It's up to you if you want to wear that or not. All right. For the interview. But if they ask you to wear a specific attire, specific colors, do follow that. So it is always, always recommended to read all the requirements they're looking for in a candidate, all right, for the interview part. All right? Any doubts, Suparna?
No, all right. All right.
All right, that was all about the grooming part. Anything you want to ask, you want to add your thoughts, please feel free. I want the session to be as interactive as possible, but for that, you need to add your thoughts, your questions, and I'll be more than happy to answer it.
Am I audible to you, Mia?
Yes. Yes,
yeah, I have a question regarding the hospitality sector. Uh-huh. Would there be any training for cabin crew? I mean, personality wise, etc. You better know about hospitality.
Right. So if you are joining like hospitality industry, right, hotels, right. So
anything, right?
Yeah. So this training is actually. be gonna beneficial for the hotel industry and tanning. All right. Okay. So whatever I'm telling you about the grooming part will also work in the hospitality industry. They will be having their different grooming standards that you need to follow. Mm-hmm. All right. But the interview thing is pretty much the same. Like the way you need to get dressed for the interview, the way you need to introduce, everything is the same.
Mm-hmm.
But if you have any specific question about it, you can ask. Jenny, right?
I'm Jenny, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Mm-hmm.
So Jenny, are you from hotel topic of aviation vocabulary? All right. We are aviation and there is a term for it. It is called aviation English and it is internationally recognized language of aviation. So once you become a part of the airline or any hotel industry, I would recommend to use words that I'm going to tell you, all right? Aisle, we call it aisle or aisle seat, okay? The long empty space that you walk down in an aircraft and the seat that is next to it is the aisle seat. So if you have seen any aircraft, okay, you must have seen this passage in the middle, right, between two rows. This is called aisle and the seat right next to it is an aisle seat. This is just not in the aircraft. If you are traveling, let's say in a train, there also you get this passage, right? Even over there, we call it an aisle. Right, the seat right next to this passage is an aisle seat. Okay, so it's good to refer it as an aisle seat. Let's say if you are booking your ticket for a leisure trip and you are calling to the travel advisor of that airline, you can, you know, go ahead and say, I'm looking for an aisle seat or I'm looking for a window seat. So the seat which is by the window, it's gonna be the window seat. And the name for the middle one is very easy. It's a middle seat, all right? So window, middle, and aisle, all right? So this is how you're gonna name them, okay? Again, you're gonna use this word in aviation or hospitality with it, which is baggage. The bags and suitcases that travelers put their belongings in, all right? So you're going to refer them as baggage. How many baggage do you have? Okay. You can, hotel people, they also refer it as luggage, which is absolutely fine. All right. But in aviation, we only refer it as baggage. How many baggages you are carrying? All right. So this is how you're going to refer it. Okay. All these are baggages. These are not trolleys or suitcases. Do not refer it as them. Just baggage. All right. Now you must have seen it because you cannot fly without this, right? A boarding pass. So boarding pass identifies the passenger, the flight number, and date, schedule, time of departure. One more thing which is not mentioned in the statement, but the boarding card has. Anyone can tell. It is not mentioned in the statement, but a boarding card has that information and it is very important information. What is that? Any guesses? You guys can refer to the boarding pass, which is over there on the screen, and let me know what is the information missing in the statement.
Is this passenger name?
No, identify the passenger is the passenger name actually.
Yeah.
So the flight number is there, identifies the passenger means they, of course, passenger name would be there, flight number would be there, date and schedule time of the departure. One more thing
seat
which is
number.
Missing.
Seat.
Yes, who said?
Susmita.
Okay, great. Yes, seat number. Okay, so it is not mentioned in the statement, but seat number is the most important information that would be mentioned on your boarding pass, all right? Because sometimes you do not book the seats in advance, you book it at the time of check-in, all right? So it may not be in your ticket, but it will surely be in your boarding pass, all right? Otherwise, crew would not be able to redirect you to your seat if your boarding card doesn't have this information, all right? So, seat number, all right? Any doubts on that, anyone? So this is cockpit, and we also refer it as flight deck, all right? So most of the airline, they also refer this room as flight deck, all right? Cockpit is also correct, and flight deck is also correct. So with Vistara, we used to refer it as flight deck only, because they have the only term for cockpit, which was flight deck, right? Now, this is the most important part of the aircraft, which is the cabin. Since you guys are people who wants to join the airline as cabin crew, you guys will be the crew in this particular part of the aircraft, which is cabin. That's why we call you as a cabin crew, all right? And pilots would be referred as flight deck or cockpit crew, all right? But you are cabin crew, right? The part of the aircraft where passengers travel. And when you get on a plane, find your seat, the space that you are in is the aircraft cabin, okay? Most important part of the aircraft, all right? Commercial aircraft, I should say, right? So this is the economy cabin, and this is the business class cabin, all right? One of the most important feature for the passenger and for us as well, the call bell and the call button. So passenger will be pressing the call bell to call a cabin crew if they need any help or any assistance, all right? Or if they need anything, right? So it is a button which will be available around the seat. Okay, in this picture, it is actually right above the seat, all right? Okay, but in different aircraft, you will find this button in different places. You will get to know later on, once you join any airline, they will train you on every aircraft that they are flying on. And then you can always check, because you need to get yourself familiarized with all the aircraft they'll be flying on, all right? So call bell, call button. Do not ignore the call from the passengers, all right? Sometimes you'll be so tired to take it, but then you still have to take it, all right? Any doubts in that? Anyone? Okay. Now, procedure. The process of getting off from the plane. We call it disembarkation or deplane. All right. So like if you are working as a ground staff, or let's say a ground staff is talking to you and said, you know, disembarkation is happening, and you as a passenger do not know what disembarkation means, right? So always refer deplaning or passenger getting off from the plane as disembarkation or deplane. All right. The process of getting off from the plane as disembarkation or deplane, right? Embarkation and enplaning. So process of boarding an aircraft. People getting on board. The process is called the embarkation or enplane. All right. So this is how you're gonna refer, right? Boarding is also fine, like the boarding is happening, or embarkation is happening, or disembarkation is happening. Deboarding is also fine, all right? So try use these terms in aviation. Or maybe you're talking to a travel advisor, travel agent, or any aviation personnel as a passenger. So use these terms, all right? Jet lag. So tiredness due to traveling through different time zones. So one of the, not a problem, but then you need to get along with this, all right? So you will feel jet lag when you will be traveling through different time zones. And what jet lag is, it's like when your body clock is synchronized with the original time zone, the time zone that where you have come from, right? And then when the synchronization gets disrupted, you feel jet lag. It's like temporary lack of sleep or difficulty in sleeping, let's say, when your body and your mind is not getting synchronized because of the time zones, right? And you may feel when you will be traveling from one time zone to another every day, right? So your body needs rest as well. So do not worry, your airline has made that arrangement. Say they, of course, they will make sure the crew are getting rest properly. They all are well rested before the flight, because you need to be, right? You do not do a flight with a tired mind or body, right? Because you need to, you will be doing a lot of safety procedures for that. Your mind needs to be in a good position, right? Very normal terminology, I think everybody is using it, landing. So aircraft returning to the ground after being in the air is landing. I think that is the only term everybody is using, right? Aircraft is landing, right? Now, this one you have to pay a little bit of attention on. It is pretty confusing, but easy as well. Layover. Okay. A stop as short as 30 minutes or up to 24 hours on international flights. So I'm going to give you an example to explain it. For example, you are going from Delhi to Port Blair. All right. And your flight will be stopping in Kolkata for 1 hour, okay, but you will be continuing your journey to Port Blair, okay. Then you can say that you have a layover of 1 hour in Kolkata. That is the domestic I'm talking about, all right. And in international, it's gonna be, let's say you are traveling to Delhi to New York with a stop in Germany, let's say, all right. So stop is for, let's say, 8 hours. Then you can say that you have a layover of 8 hours in Germany, right? So this is the term I'm telling you as per the passenger, as per the customer, all right? As a crew, you will be having different terminology for that, all right? What you will refer layover as, when you are going, as a crew, now I'm telling you, pay attention over here. If you're going from Delhi to New York, you're operating this flight as a cabin crew. It's your duty, right? Delhi to New York, and you are staying in New York for, let's say, 2 days. Then that would be called as layover for you, even if it is more than 24 hours, okay? So pay attention on your part only, okay? If passenger, you know, comes to you and say that, I have a stop in Kolkata, because they don't know what layover is, right? So I have a stop in Kolkata for 1 hour. I don't know what they're going to do over there. Why is the stop over? Well, all you can say is, sir, yes, we have a brief layover in Kolkata. You know, as a ground staff or as a travel advisor, that's how you can refer it. But as a cabin crew, layover is the time wherein you will be resting, right, in some other country, not at your base, some other country after operating the flight. You are still on your duty, okay? Though you can go roam around, have fun, that's fine, but then still you will be on your duty, all right? Stopover. A stopover that lasts longer than 4 hours for domestic flight and longer than 24 hours for international flight. So here it was as short as 30 minutes up to 4 hours for domestic. But anything longer than 4 hours for domestic is stopover. And anything which is longer than 24 hours for international is a stopover for international flights. All right? Confusing? Or you're good? Okay. Overbooked. Even hoteliers use this word. Why? Because they also booking rooms for people. Like airline, they're booking seats for people. Hotels are booking room for people. So sometimes what they do is they overbooked it. What do you mean by overbooked it? More passengers than available seat, or more customers than available rooms. All right, for the hotel. Sometimes they do an overbooking. that is totally for the business purpose, all right? Like to prevent like some passenger or some customer, they do not show, right? So preventing these kind of incident, they always overbook. And if everybody shows up, then they have to make arrangements for them, for those people, right? Both of the industry I'm talking about. So if an airline make an overbooking for a flight and all of the passengers shows up, then airline, they have to give them different, they have to rebook them. Airline have to rebook the passengers, all right? Overhead bin or compartment. You must have seen in the aircraft, the place above the seat for storing luggage is called overhead bin, overhead compartment, all right? You may hear people calling it as hat rack. It's fine. We used to call it in like long time back. So hat rack is also okay, but refer it as overhead bin. All right. Runway, the strip of land that airplane takes off and lands on. Very self-explanatory. Yeah. That is again for the customer, not for the cabin. Transit. I'll just tell you brief about it. So if you are a travel advisor, let's say, all right, when you are in transit, you resume or continue your journey with the brief layover at the airport with the same airline and with the same flight number and boarding card. I gave you an example of Delhi to Kolkata to Port Blair, right? So in Kolkata, you are just sitting in that same plane and you are continuing your journey with the same boarding card and the same flight number. So you are in transit. But let's say in Kolkata, you have to change the planes or airline. Like you're traveling from Delhi to Kolkata on IndiGo, but from Kolkata to Port Blair, you have to take SpiceJet. So that means you are making a transfer, right? You're making a transfer. But you, if you're traveling with the same airline, same flight number, continuing journey with the same aircraft, then you are just transiting. All right. Any questions in that, guys?